through on the inside his dreams end. And it looks as if a large action's going to be pulled up. Large action is being pulled up, only having jumped two flights of hurdles. And it's Make a Stand then leading as they race past the stands. And it's clear by five. Two Mister getting second, and then Collier Bay. Then Guest Performance and Binzi and San Martino and Dargini, followed by Dreams End and I'm Supposing Hill Society and Pridwell. Then we've got Space Truck at the inside of Cockney Lad, but he's dismounted off Large Action's Jamie Osborne.
Tonight, the secretive world of horse race cheats. We expose the top trainers prepared to fix races.
No, I'm cheating. Not cheating, it's just using the system.
Other cheats who call it just using the system include this man. How do we know? He was training our horse.
He's been an old fiddler horse all his life, like, you know.
He's been a what?
Well, fiddling horse, like, you know.
A fiddling horse.
There are.
Over several weeks, he fixed our horse to run slower, to line it up for a gamble where we'd make a fortune. Who was he cheating? The betting public.
Fiddling horse, please don't hit me. What's a fiddling horse?
What you're about to see will send shockwaves through the sport. It's the biggest gambling industry in the UK. Every year, £5 billion is bet on the horses. Everybody expects the horse they've backed will try to win. That's why they put their money on it.
But tonight we'll show you that for some in the sport, it's more about losing rather than winning. In fact, they'll go to extraordinary lengths to make sure their horse goes slower. For their brand of fixing, the further down the field the horse comes, the better. And whilst they're making money out of it, the losers are you and I, the betting public.
If you're going to put a bet on something, you want to know that that horse has got a chance of winning.
They shouldn't be taking part, they're not out to win.
It's a jockey and a trainer work, then they must be going out to try and win a race. And if they're not, then there's obviously a kickback somewhere, and it should be investigated.
The people here at the Jockey Club would agree. It's the sport's governing body, and it has strict rules to prevent what's called non-trying.
Jockey Club Rule 155. Every horse which runs in a race shall be run on its merits.
And goes on to say that neither shall the trainer
or any other person prevent or try to prevent in any way any horse from winning a race or obtaining the best possible placing.
The rules exist so that when you bet at the races, you can be sure the horse you put your money on is trying to win. Few in the sport will speak out about how often that basic rule is broken. But we found one former jockey prepared to talk, so long as we hid his identity.
Your ordinary punter has got no chance. It's very serious, it's been going on and always will go on. Sorry for the jockeys and trainers, because they're still getting a few quid out of it. But your punter has got no chance.
He should know, he fixed races himself for years.
Many times I've picked up £1,000, £2,000 for getting beat on one. And if I'd won on it, I'd have only drawn £250, £300.
What he was doing was stopping a favourite, shorthand for slowing it down so it wouldn't win. Others hold horses back to reduce their handicap. That's the key to this kind of race fixing.
Now, in the horse's saddle, there are a series of weights. Part of the handicapping system. If the horse is running poorly, the racing authorities can reduce the amount of weight in the saddle, so the horse should be able to run a little bit quicker. So if you hold the horse back race after race, the amount of weight in the saddle is reduced and the horse gets an unfair advantage over everybody else in the race.
Now it's two steps to go. Olivia Rose tries to nip up the far side rail but denied him.
So when you finish your cheating, the handicap's been reduced, you wait for your moment, you put your money on, you let the horse run properly, and bang, you should be a winner.
So, how easy is it to do? I posed as a wealthy businessman with a weakness for gambling. I had to learn the jargon, the etiquette, and the way cheats work. Would any top trainer offer to cheat a horse's handicap down, so when the brakes were off in a future race, the horse could romp home first and make a fortune.
Now, the only way we're going to get close to some of these people is if we actually buy a horse and get one of them to train it, because that way at least they should trust us. It shows that we're serious, and it also means that we can go backwards and forwards and secretly film the whole process of hopefully fixing a race.
And it's Clay County being pressed all the time by Colton over on the far side, and Colton's going to get up at the line. Colton is the winner.
A storming finish there by Colton under Jamie Osborne.
Jamie Osborne was one of the greatest jockeys of all time over the jumps. He won the Hennessy Gold Cup twice. In all, he rode more than 900 winners worldwide. But in 1998, his career looked in danger. He was arrested with others on suspicion of race-fixing. After nearly a year, though, the case was thrown out. He was never charged. Now he's based here, in Lambourne. No longer a jockey, he's an up-and-coming trainer. Some of the horses in his stables are for sale.
Hello, Matthew Jones.
Hi, James. Hi.
We wanted to buy one and have him train it. Early in the conversation, he gave us a choice, a horse to try to win races with, or a horse with which we could make money through gambling.
You can only turn the odds in your favour and give yourself an edge and still have a horse at a reasonable price where you can get the money, and if you cheat.
Okay.
And we'll cheat. We don't mind cheating. Not cheating, it's just using the system.
The way Osborne uses the system involves his horses deliberately losing. He says the horse won't be wound up properly. That's jargon for not trying to win. Initially, he'll undertrain it and run it over an unsuitable distance. The idea, to cheat down the handicap.
If you're going to have a bet, you actually, you don't win as many races as you possibly might, because you're trying to line something up for a bet.
Yeah.
I can't offer a guarantee with it, but what I can do is turn as many of the factors as possible in our favour. So to all intents and purposes, the horse looks crap.
Crap? Osborne wouldn't tell the people betting on it that he'd purposefully made the horse appear crap. Some in racing have said we're being naive and simplistic for saying he's done anything wrong. Yet what he's suggesting is totally against the rules and would be defrauding the betting public.
Yeah, we'd be ideal. A, because we can do it. And B, because we do it so infrequently that we're not renowned for it. And I know every Trump would say this, but if that's what you want, I've got the perfect instrument.
Really. Osborne has subsequently said we caught him off guard and that he made some stupid remarks because he was desperate to sell us a horse. In our secret filming, he said he doesn't do this often, that it's his priority to win as many races as possible, but then he offered to cheat by losing races initially with a view to racing it properly later. Would the jockey be in on it?
I mean, how does the jockey know?
If you're doing what we were talking about, yes, has to, and therefore we would use an in-house man. I can get any jockey to ride any horse if you want, but if you're doing something like this, you use in-house. I've got a very good one, very experienced, very good. Very much on side, like that.
Our jockey insider told us how he used to disguise the fact he was racing to lose.
You pick your arm up as though you're hitting it and you're not hitting it. You go around the back straight, you can pretend you're hitting a horse. The punters, I see, think you're trying on one and you're not. It's easy to raise your right or left arm.
We were off to see another trainer. He's one of the most well-known and successful in the sport.
But have a look at this for a big win. Might be a big day for Ferdy Murphy.
To a native wit trained by Ferdy Murphy.
Ferdy Murphy is up there behind.
Ferdy Murphy, one of the country's top 10 jump trainers. But in the late 90s, he was twice fined under the non-trying rules. We arranged to meet him at a hotel in Darlington. We'd already told him we wanted a horse specifically for gambling. He said he had one which could win first time out for us. But then the conversation turned. He said he knew how to intentionally prevent a horse from doing its best and how to get away with it.
But your chance of now doing that are getting slimmer by the minute, because they've now got so much technology to put cameras up your ass on the race course, so it's getting harder and harder. The only way to do that is at home. You want to make sure you have it stopped at home, you know.
Stopped at home? They always talk in code, these guys.
What do you mean stopped at home?
Well, just leave her. Don't do anything with her.
Oh, I see, sorry. Yeah.
Just make sure they blow up.
What does blow up?
Well, I mean, unfit. Make sure just that bit unfit, you know.
And how do you do that? Just...
just you ease up on your walk at home, you know, so it's easy enough done, you know.
And who would know about that, just...
It's just like you running a race, running a marathon. If you're not ready, you won't finish.
Yeah.
And you make sure this thing wouldn't finish. It's very easy to do, because to have it the day you want it, it's got to be 100%. But to get it beat, you only have to have it 75 or 80%.
Yeah.
You're guaranteed to get beat.
So, Murphy says he'll intentionally under-train a horse so it'll perform badly to get its handicap lowered. The betting public would never know what he was doing.
Have to be sort of in top form before it run a race. I don't think anything unfit should run.
They should say, like, we're putting this horse in only to make up the numbers. Do not bet on it, you know what I mean? That's a different story altogether then.
And it's cheating, isn't it? It's not a fair race, is it? And it's money been losing by people.
Then we met this man, Dave Wintle, a trainer with 20 years' experience. He's been in serious trouble before for holding a horse back. The jockey club gave him a three-month ban. We met him in the bar at the racetrack in Huntingdon. It wasn't long before the talk turned to gambling. Could he be lining us up to sell us a horse to cheat with?
We want to buy a horse.
I'm telling you, I don't want to win it. You pull this horse, he will do the job. I'll tell you that now.
He invited us round to his house to talk further. It's in the Cotswolds near Cheltenham. Like Osborne and Murphy, he knew the best way to slow a horse down. He also knew how to handle the jockey.
What are you going to say to him?
Well, look, I just don't knock him about.
What does that mean?
Well,
don't what? Don't hit him?
Don't hit him, no.
And, oh, that means so you don't...
Yeah, that's right.
You don't whip him on the back, so they go... Because it's all code to use.
Yeah. You've got to remember, you know, when I'm saying things, I don't know you from sort of...
No.
Do you understand what I mean?
Yeah. No. Don't worry, I just want to make sure that...
Well, they do send people out to sort of check, you know, of trainers and that, like, you know. Yeah, honestly.
Who do they say? How can they
Who's that?
They send people out and ask about putting a horse with you and ask if you do, you know, these things happen like
Who's
that?
Who's that? Jockey Club?
Jockey
Pete?
Club, yeah.
In fact, the Jockey Club weren't onto Wintle. They were onto us. A warning letter was sent to the National Trainers Federation, who told its members to look out for us. It said,
"It is possible that two men purporting to be potential owners are, in fact, undercover reporters and may be seeking to damage the reputation of racing. Be warned."
Now, why would they need to do that if there are no cheats in the sport? Anyway, nobody so far had rumbled us. Now we had to choose which trainer to go with.
Right, we finally decided we're going to buy our horse through that trainer called Dave Wintle, because, I mean, he's been pretty guarded in a few of the meetings, but there's been one or two sort of monster hints there that he is prepared to do something. Hello, mate. Hello.
he's a lovely horse.
Well, you know, I mean, it looks lovely to me, but I wouldn't know. You look lovely, don't you? Hello.
They all look nice until you get the first bill through.
1, 2.
The horse we're buying is Seattle Alley, last a winner 4 months before. He's a 9-year-old, and he's got a great pedigree. His grandfather was the superstar Derby winner, Nijinsky. Amazingly, he was once ridden by Jamie Osborne. £4,000 later, he was ours, and back at the house, Mr. Wintle let us into a secret.
He's been a old fiddler horse all his life, like, you know.
He's been a what?
Well, fiddling horse, like, you know.
A fiddling horse?
Really?
Well, he plays the fiddle.
Yeah, he's always been a jobber, like, you know.
We went to see a bookie, who's fixed races himself, to ask him what a fiddling horse is. Understandably, he too wants his identity hidden.
It means they've run the horse down the field with no intentions of winning with it. Then they're going to have a touch with it and go to win, probably a big price.
So a fiddling horse means a cheating horse, does it?
Exactly, yes.
And that's precisely what Dave Wintle was going to do with Seattle Alley.
It's a dangerous game.
Yeah.
Believe you me. It's a good game played quietly.
And it's also against the rules.
No trainer shall prevent or try to prevent in any way any horse from winning a race or of obtaining the best possible placing.
Now, all owners have their own silks or colours that the jockey rides in, and we thought Seattle Alley, Stars and Stripes.
Warwick Racecourse, March the 9th, and Wintle's first chance to cheat down Seattle Alley's handicap for the fix. Right, it's the day of our first race, and Seattle Alley, our horse, is tipped to win in some of the newspapers. In the Racing Post, it's the highest rated for speed and form.
I mean, a few people would be putting their money on it today, but we know what's really going to happen because our trainers told us. It's not even trying. The race is a fix. It'll come well down the field.
But what happens if it runs really well? Can it do?
It won't do, no. It won't, no. I'm pretty certain of that, yeah.
Okay, and how can you make sure? Do you have a word with the jockey?
Yeah. That'll be sort of... He wouldn't go in that ground, I know, but it's no... You know, you just... And he's running probably one side of his distance.
Yeah.
You leave that department.
Yeah. So I'll leave that to you.
Yeah.
Good luck anyway.
All right.
Despite being tipped in some of the newspapers, the odds on the course are 12 to 1. So, if you put a tenner on him and he came first, you'd win £120.
Passing over 2 miles then to the open and a crumbling conditional jockey's handicap hurdle, they come down to the first of eight. Seattle Alley is held up towards the rear as they come down towards flight number two. Held up towards the back, Saturday's lad has got plenty of cover, and Seattle Alley as they get themselves set for flight number three. Play 5 first is still towards the back with Presidio, Seattle Alley. Towards the back of the field, Seattle Alley is being driven along but with little known response. And here's the final flight for Sir Walter and Barry Kennery. Draws towards it, runs out to the left, but he's nimble footed out over it, lands clear. To Mallory, who's sticking on in second.
He finally came 13 out of 19. Good result for Wintle, bad result for the punters who backed it. It's impossible to say how much they lost on the fiddling horse, Seattle Alley. We retired to the bar to celebrate losing and to find out what will happen to the handicap.
What effect will today's race have?
You've got £3 or £4.
I won.
Hopefully you will drop any handicap, £3 or £4.
That's good.
Big, yeah.
Seattle Alley's handicap fell by 5 points. Next race, weight would be taken off him.
The only thing that does stop horses winning is carrying weight. Carrying lumps of lead in their saddle. If you win, they put a £7 penalty on you, and you've got to carry, it's like carrying one pound bags of sugar around with you, the weight. But if you haven't got to carry £7 bags of sugar around, you've got a better chance. Because it's only weight that stops horses winning.
So what happens if you lose repeatedly?
Your weight goes down. You get a very low handicap.
Fontwell Racecourse, West Sussex. 2 weeks after our first race, and a chance for Wintle to cheat the handicap down even further. Seattle Alley's in the 425, with a field of 16 runners. The prize money is £2,500. No fear of getting that. Wintle's already decided where he wants Seattle Alley to finish.
The way the handicap system is, if they finish out of the first eight, they just finish fourth, fifth. They don't run them, you know, but yeah, hopefully they'll finish sort of something like that.
10 to 11.
So, the better Seattle Alley runs, the more of a problem it is for Dave Wintle. Completely the reverse of what those betting on it would want.
Seattle Alley, broad side of the tape.
This is it, it's the second race. And I think we already know what's going to happen. Because our train has already told us it's going to come probably 10th or even worse than that.
They're under starters' orders, they're off. And away they go then for the Racing Post handicap hurdle. Seattle Alley is right towards the rear of the main group. Gordy's also towards the rear.
You've got to be right, hope they're not making it, hope the jockey's not making it to win. He's at well now.
Seattle Alley came in 8 out of 16. That's bad enough to mean another drop in handicap. We won't find out by how much until later. Jockeys aren't allowed to bet on races, trainers are. But if they do it in the way you're about to hear, they could be banned from racing. This is an internet site called Betfair. Anyone can get on here and set themselves up as an anonymous bookie. Then they can take bets from the public. Sounds fine. But what about if you were betting on a horse to win and the internet bookie behind the screen knew it hadn't got a chance because he's actually the trainer? The betting public would never know. And that's what Ferdy Murphy told us he's done.
If you took a little house down to Fenton and we just Christmas said and
in the jargon, taking bets is known as laying.
So you were late?
You were late, yeah. I just wanted to see what was going on. I just had a feel.
So you knew he wasn't going to come in anyway?
I was guaranteed he wasn't
going to So, he said he took bets on his horse, which he could guarantee wouldn't win, and made £1,600. Nice scam. Ferdy Murphy declined to give us an interview, but he told a newspaper he's never used Betfair in his life and that he only said he had to protect the owner. From what, though, he never said. You tops at a racecourse in Staffordshire. It's Easter Monday, and the 2.55 is the big one. Since Seattle Alley's last race, his handicap rating has fallen again, by 4 points this time, and he's racing in a lower class. Wintle thinks it's time to place our money on and let him race properly. So today, Seattle Alley will be trying to win. Wintle puts the money on for us.
£750 each way.
He doesn't do it on the course because he doesn't want to draw attention to what's going on. So he does it via a contact in Spain. We told him we'd put another £4,000 on elsewhere, although we hadn't. At odds of 6-1, if Seattle Alley wins, we'll stand to gain almost £19,000. Before the race, Wintle briefs the jockey.
Once you start, once you go round here, there's a circuit to go, just keep passing him, and he does that.
But good luck with this one, seriously.
Cheers,
you need it.
Cheers.
They're under starters' orders, and they're on.
For the Peter J. Douglas Engineering selling handicap hurdle, 2.5 miles, 10 flights of hurdle.
Right, our race has just started.
And your pace on these early stages, Charles Dupont making the strong gallop.
He's holding back a bit at the beginning.
And he comes to it now with Charles Dupont continuing still to show the way, but only 2 or 3 lengths clear now from a wicked hot now.
He's still in a good position.
He's starting now to run towards the home turn. Apple Alley and Faith the Gun comes next as they swing into the home straight. It's quite new and quick to run.
He'd seemed to be in a strong position, but with just 2 fences to go, Seattle Alley had pulled up. So what had happened?
When I've gone for him, he's completely lost his action. I mean, he's going really short and he's rolling all over the place.
He's travelling well,
turning in. Pulled out to walk, he did feel a bit lame in front, and then when I've got off him and walked him back, he's come sound, but honestly.
there was nothing wrong with the horse, Wintle said a vet later checked it. Whatever was going on, the punters had already been conned in the two previous races.
The cheating is happening is when the horse is on trying, which is in 9 cases out of 10.
It's not when the horse is finally off and it's supposed to win.
No, no, it's not cheating then, no. No, it's really trying then. The horse is trying. Previously it wouldn't be trying. That's when the cheating's taking place.
A Birmingham hotel a few weeks later. Wintle had arranged to meet us here for a night out with some of his racing associates.
Yeah, it's good to see you, Tim. I haven't seen you for a while. That's fine.
He assured us, next time out, the horse would win. Ironically, by pulling up at Uttoxeter, its handicap had fallen again. I didn't know it then, but this was the last time I'd see Wintle undercover.
We were having a drink in this nightclub with Mr. Wintle and some of his associates. What we didn't realise was that they'd left one of their party back at the hotel, who went through our rooms, found our secret filming equipment, and stole some of the tapes that we'd made. So the first I knew about it was when one of their number took me into the toilets here and beat me up. We've been rumbled, basically. It was the end of our investigation into Dave Wintle, the race fixer.
We wanted to talk to Mr. Wintle about his cheating and caught up with him at Stratford Racecourse.
Mr. Wintle, Paul Kenyon from BBC Television, you fix horse races, don't you? Mr. Wintle, you fix horse races and you've been doing it for years. Mr. Wintle, that's an assault.
You get out.
What does a fiddling horse mean, Mr. Please don't hit me. What does a fiddling... Ah! Mr. Wintle, what's a fiddling horse mean?
You get out.
What does a fiddling horse mean, Mr. Wintle? Mr. Wintle, what's a fiddling horse mean? Just tell me.
The Jockey Club declined to appear on the programme. In a statement, it said, if there's any doubt about a horse being run on its merits, it holds an inquiry. Last year, it held 242 of them and found 55 cases that were in breach of the rules. The club also said that in view of the inextricable links racing has with betting, it had been naive to think that owners and trainers never try to gain an advantage for themselves through their choice of race and tactics. But the club spends £17 million a year trying to protect the sport's integrity and to catch the cheats.
Would it be fair to say that most races in this country are carved up, are cheated?
They're not carved up, but there's horses running not on their merits in every race.
And who's the winner in all this?
The winner in all this is, first of all, the trainer has got to get money. The bookmakers have got to get money. And the people who lose are the punters. Everybody's got to get their money from the public. That's where all the money comes from.
We've now moved Seattle Alley to a new set of stables. He's no longer a fiddling horse. Some will say everything we've revealed tonight about Dave Wintle, Jamie Osborne and Ferdy Murphy is simply bending the rules or gamesmanship and nothing new. But it will be to anybody outside the closed world of racing who's ever had a little flutter on a horse.